Hello, I'm Gypsy Metellus, and welcome to Haitian Voices. Haitian Voices is a new monthly program introducing you to diverse voices in South Florida's Haitian-American community. So we'll bring you artists, writers, entrepreneurs, as well as faith and political leaders. This March, as we highlight the many contributions made by women in our local and global society, this edition of Haitian Voices will spotlight four Haitian-American women in Miami-Dade who are writing new chapters of activism and making an impact on our community. So today we begin with Wanda Tima, who's a vlogger, curator, and social media marketing manager at L'Union Suite, and Fabiola Florenville, who's CEO at Blueprint Creative Group. Welcome to the program, ladies. It's such a pleasure to have you. Happy Women's History Month.
Happy Women's History Month.
And
thank you.
Let's begin with you, Wanda. So what's a vlogger?
A vlogger is a person that blogs via video. So all it basically means is the same as blogging, but you're using video to actually tell your story instead of writing it.
So in this new form of media, you're blogging, you're doing a number of wonderful things. So what inspires you to do all of this work?
Well, because my platform is basically based on Haitians and the culture and the people and the country, that's what inspires me. Because I originally started on my platform because I noticed there was a need for it, because we didn't really have like a large social media presence, and we didn't really have blogs. It was more like news. So I wanted to create a platform where we're basically free to talk about whatever we wanted to talk about in the community.
Using new media, which is wonderful.
Yes.
And Fabiola Florenville, creative. What is the name of your outfit again?
Blueprint Creative.
So talk a little bit about that. What motivated you to create this entity?
Well, Blueprint Creative Group is a marketing agency that I've had since 2007. And so by profession, I've always been in the marketing field. But as an entrepreneur, even at a young age, I always knew that I would be in business for myself. So I remember at the age of 7, just letting the people know around me, my friends and my family, that, you know, I was essentially not going to work for anyone, that I wanted to go into business. So I naturally just took that path. I remember selling chips and candy at 7, not because I needed the money, but I was enterprising. So it was more so about me having that little hustle in me. And so just from that point, going on to college, grad school, I've always had that same track of being in marketing and being an entrepreneur. And so when I came out of grad school, instead of taking the traditional route of going into the corporate, I decided to start up my marketing company.
So this month, you know, month of March, Women's History Month, how do you see yourself making history, Wanda?
I see myself making history by using, like I said, the media, social media, and basically exposing our culture to people in the world that otherwise wouldn't even know we're doing some of the things that we're doing, and we're in some of the professional fields that they don't, you know, normally hear Haitians in, and seeing Haiti through a different view. So instead of people just seeing us through Google pictures of, you know, depression, you're able to see the country from a different view via social network, where a single picture can literally be shared a million times within an hour. So my goal is to always make sure, like I always say, that my goal is to make sure Haiti is always trending in the positive light. So that's basically how I see myself.
Were you born in Haiti?
I was born in Haiti, I was there for like a day or two. But I wasn't there long, but I was born in Cape Haitian, and then I grew up and was raised in Turks and Caicos.
Okay, yeah. And you've been in Miami how long now?
I've been in Miami for like 15 to 16 years now.
Okay. Yeah. So you went to school here?
Yes, I went to school. I went to William Dandy Middle School, and then I went to Dillard High School, and I went on to Bethune-Cookman University. Then I went to get my master's in Texas at STEM Houston State.
Fantastic. And Fabiola, were you born in Haiti or were you born here in the United
States? I was born
here. Okay.
Yeah.
All right. So you two represent two of the, you know, leading Haitian, young Haitian American women. You're doing wonderful things, you know, marketing firm, social media, you know, you're always trending. Both of you are always trending. So let's talk a little bit about how you view yourself making a mark and on the Haitian community itself. Never mind your professional contributions, but how are you using your professional skills to advance issues or causes that are important, not just to the Haitian community, but to the Miami-Dade community at large?
I always say that people ask me, like, how are you able to do some of the things that you've done in so fast? Mm-hmm. And I've always told people it's because I took everything that I basically learned in school and I took it and brought it to my company. So marketing, PR, media, you know, anything that I did with in school, I use it now for my company, whether it's like what Fabiola does with the way that I market it, the way the visuals are, just making sure the content always look professional and making sure the stories are accurate and, you know, being on top of things and, you know, understanding how the media work. Like once you put something out there, it's out there. Like you can't take that information back. So being careful with what we share, making sure we're accurate and making sure it's something that everyone in our culture can be proud of, no matter how old you are. If you see us representing you anywhere, like you'll actually be proud of what we're doing.
Excellent. And how about you, Fabiola? How do you want to make your mark or leave your mark on this community?
Well, my marketing company, I always say I have two lives. So my marketing company is more of my corporate and business life. So that's always there. But it's really about how do I engage here? And so it's not something that I actually pursued to be this civic or community person here, but really just in my involvement and just seeing as an entrepreneur, when you see problems, your first instinct is where can I insert myself to address issues or be a peer leader in that area? So as an example, within the Black community, when we started up the Miami Millennial Investment firm for our Buy Back the Block campaign, it was because we see this changing Miami that's not really fitting for us as Black people, as Haitian Caribbean people, and seeing our neighborhoods change, the dynamics of it, and seeing newcomers come in and take over communities. So our goal was to be the ones to go in and be that impact and change versus just sitting back idle, just complaining. So we came in and said, we want to be the ones that take control of our communities. And so we started the investment group to purchase properties. But that's in the same case of all the other groups that I'm involved with. It's really about where there is a need, where there is an issue, and not being the person to sit by the sideline and instead going in and be that problem solver for
Fantastic.
It.
Fantastic. So who are your role models? And your role models don't necessarily have to be exclusively women. But, this is March, the month of March, and we're celebrating women. So I'd like to see it, hear from you. Who are your the role models that you would select?
Honestly, my role model has always been and still is my mother. Mm-hmm. I was raised in a family with a lot of women. So I grew up watching all these professional women. My mom owns her own business. My aunts, you know, basically have their own businesses. So I grew up in this world where everyone kind of pushed entrepreneurship and pushed leaders. So everything that I've always done has always been in that, like seeing how my mom and my aunts and my family members did the things that they do. And even now in my community with a lot of people I work with in my business, I'm around women all the time. So I'm always inspired by other women and what they do and learning from them and being able to basically network and market with the women in my community. So I take bits and pieces of all the women that I'm around, since that's kind of been my life, always been around women. So I take bits and pieces from all of the women and kind of use that as inspiration for things that I'm going through or I've done or haven't done or things that I'm learning.
Mm-hmm. Fantastic. Same question to you, Fabiola. Who are your role models?
Well, I look at role models as mentors. So besides the typical person that's shaped and molded you, I pick up mentors in every aspect, in every area. So I tell people, for example, I have a 101-year-old girlfriend who lives in Harlem, and people laugh when I say that, but she's actually someone that, as a woman that's been there, that's made her mark, especially at a time when we were, when we couldn't be champions in certain areas. That's who I call and talk to. But I have several other mentors in different aspects of business, from real estate to my actual community life to my business. And so I pick up the phone anytime I have an issue, but it's not really about what I need from them, but also being of value to them as well.
Mm-hmm. So how do you want to be remembered? You know, and I know that's an awkward question, but what do you want to, What's the mark you want to leave?
Well, I never really think about how I want to be remembered. You know, for me, there's just...
It's an odd question. I'm not suggesting anything.
No, here, but really, there's this role that I play in life, right? So I was given to this earth for a purpose. God put me here for a purpose. And it's not really me just searching what is my purpose, but just knowing what the voice is in my head and just being guided by that spirit that just leads me there. And so everything
that... what's the voice telling you?
Well, the voice... I'm this fearless person, so I never sit back and wait. you know, instead of being that person to knock on the door, I'll open the door myself, and if I have to kick it, I'll kick it myself.
Wow.
And so that's
how you want, that's how you're gonna be remembered.
As a kid, my parents always knew when she made up her mind, just leave her, you know, because there's no changing it. Some people may call it stubborn, but it's really about me being very secured and confident with where I'm going and led. So it started from when I was a kid. When I said I was not going to work for anyone, it was not me having that ego or that pride to say, I want to be my boss. Everyone wants to be an entrepreneur. Not everyone can be an entrepreneur. But it was really because something was already birthed in me at that time to where I said, this was what I was going to do. And I remember in the ninth grade, my mom and my counselor sat down and I told them, I'm skipping the 12th grade. And they're looking at me like, how is that possible? And I took my SATs in the ninth grade and went to my principal in the 10th grade and said, I need you to sign it off on this. And essentially, I was away at college, what was supposed to be my senior year. So I've always had that forward thinking, but I've always had this internal spirit in me that always said, okay, this is what it is going to be. And so once I already had that in my mind, there was really no turning back.
So are you treated differently as a woman, do you think?
I mean, obviously,
especially a woman in business, a woman who has her mind made up, and we can see this, you know, the fearless one.
Let me tell you how being a woman, right, being young too, there's a certain treatment that comes in because I advanced earlier, so I skipped the 12th grade, you know, that which means that I graduated at with seniors when I was not a true senior in college and grad school. So I was always the younger person. And because I'm in business, I've always been the younger person in the room. So age and gender always plays a role. And then being black also plays a role. But for me, those types of restrictions don't really matter because I don't need validation or approval from someone in order for me to do what I need to do. So, but you can clearly see differences. Being young and in business, you sometimes get that, oh, you're smart for a young girl, you know, that type
fantastic.
Of thing.
That's fantastic. Right? So the minute and a half we've got left, Wanda, what about you? You know, are you treated differently?
Oh, absolutely. I'm going to piggyback on what she just said. I'm the same thing. I graduated high school at 16 and went off to college, graduated early, was working in corporate America at like 21 years old. So I've always been like the youngest face, the black face, the woman. Like, so I've always had to, like she says, kick doors in and actually felt like I had to prove myself. So it's caused me to be like strong in everything I do. And I always start with believing myself and understanding like I'm a vessel for the things that I do. God is using me as a vessel, and as long as I have faith in myself first, there's like really nothing I literally can't do or any door I can't kick down.
That's wonderful. That's wonderful. So you guys, thank you so much for joining
us. Thank you.
In this segment.